all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth be removed, though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her that right early. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the words of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. Please bow your heads with me. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we are truly thankful and grateful to call you our God. Father, we are just, our hearts are saddened and heavy, but you're the great burden bearer. And we're so thankful that we have someone we can come to in time of need. Father, I'm asking a special prayer right now for the Bradford family and the Knight family and the Lowe family and all the family members that are here this morning, Lord, for the Hillcrest family. We're asking for your strength, your peace, and your comfort that passes all understanding. Lord, we just praise you and we thank you for what you've done and what you're about to do this day. For this is our prayer in your precious and holy divine name we pray.
For our scripture, I would like to read from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, beginning at verse 1. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying, and there shall be no more pain. For the former things have passed away." Then he who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said to me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful."
Good afternoon, everybody. I am Mary Bradford's niece, daughter of Joseph and Pearlie Scott, her sister, brother-in-law. I was here in June and got a chance to see and hug my aunt Taylor. I love her back in June. And so I'm so happy I had the opportunity to do that. I know when we look at the news, and we say, "Lord, how long? When you coming, Lord? I'm tired. I'm tired of seeing the evil. I'm tired of seeing the foolishness." When I was younger, the preachers preached so hard, I thought that I would never see the ripe old age of 25. And here I am, 56, and Jesus still ain't come yet. So, I wonder how many today, how many of y'all ready for Jesus to come? When there are no more crying, no more dying, no more tears, and we will be with Jesus and worship the Father forever. I pray that I see all of us in that number on that great getting up morning. The song that I sing for you is entitled, "I Bowed on My Knees and Cried Holy." And I hope that it's a song about heaven. I hope you're blessed. I dreamed of a city called glory, so bright and so fair. When I entered the gates, I cried holy. The angels, they all met me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion, and oh, the sights I saw. But then I said, "I want to see Jesus, the one who died for me. I bowed on my knees.
glory to the Son of God. I sing glory to the Son of God. As I enter the gates of that city, my loved ones all knew me well. They took me down the street of heaven. Oh, too many to tell, and I saw Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, spoke with Mark and Timothy. But I said, Timothy, I want to see my Jesus.
Gathered to celebrate the life of Sister Bradford, but not only to celebrate her life, we want to take some time to remember all of the wonderful and good times and good memories that we have of her. We also want to praise God for all of the wonderful ways he used her to touch so many lives. Amen. Everyone who knows Sister Bradford knows that she loved people, and she was meticulous in expressing her love for them. Amen. And so we are here today. There's some laughter over there, but so y'all know Sister Bradford then, amen. But so we're here today. We want to celebrate her life, and we have a lot of, I'm sure that many of us could recount so many stories and times when she did something that brought a smile to our face or wiped a tear from our eyes. And so the family selected a few individuals that would just come and share and reflect on her life and some of the ways that she touched them. And so at this time, we just want to welcome those who will be coming to share at this time, the first person being in the person of Dr. Sharon Fleming. Let's welcome her at this time.
Good afternoon, family. I come in behalf of the Personal Ministries Department, and as a sister in Christ, I was asked to give a little bit of a thought regarding Mary and her ministry to us here at Hillcrest. When I think of Mary, I think of an inspirational writing that says, Christ's method alone will give true success in reaching the people. The Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good. He showed them sympathy. He ministered to their needs, and he won their confidence. Then he bade them, follow me. I believe our sister in Christ, Mary, used Christ as her example as she ministered to others. As she went to the nursing homes, and as she visited the homeless on the streets, and as she prepared baskets in her garage for those returning to school or the sick and the shut-in. Just as Jesus didn't wait for people to come to him, he sought them out. He mingled with them. He spent time and showed interest in them. So also Mary did. Mary mingled with our youth. She mingled at the nursing home. She actually, when we went to the nursing home, she'd walk into each patient's room and touch them, smile at them, and hand them a flower. She was very upset if we ran out of flowers because she wanted everything to be perfect. Family, I think Mary would be really, really happy if we took her as an example as she took Christ as an example. If we would consider the people in our lives and in our community who are battling grief, poverty, illness, and temptations, if we ask ourselves, how can we minister to others' needs? How can we lift their burdens, encourage them in their journey, and show the sympathy of Christ? Our success will not depend so much on our knowledge or our accomplishments as upon our ability to find a way to reach them and to reach their hearts. Thank you so very much, and well done, Mary. Rest in peace.
I first met the May family in 1971 in Meridian, Mississippi, when I was a pastor of the Ephesus Church there. And I see so many of you here today. It brings back many reflections and many memories. I remember when we were building a church in Meridian, Mary was one of the most active persons raising money along with other members of her family, the May family, Sister Cook, who's not here with us today, and so many others. I don't want to try to start naming names, but I'm here to give words of comfort. At all times and in all places and in all sorrows and in all afflictions, when the outlook seems dark and the future perplexing and we feel helpless and alone, the Comforter will be sent in answer to the prayer of faith. Desire of Ages, page 669. It says the Comforter will be sent in answer to the prayer of faith. At all times, in the good times and the difficult times, the Comforter will be sent in answer to the prayer of faith. In all places, in difficult places and in lovely places, the Comforter will be sent in answer to the prayer of faith. In all sorrows, and today we're dealing with the sorrow, Sorrows are painful experiences of grief. And family and friends of Mary Bradford, we're dealing with that sorrow today. And in all afflictions. I remember in all of these afflictions and sorrows and difficulties, it says the Comforter will be sent in answer to the prayer of faith. I was kind of thinking about Sister May's 100th birthday celebration in Meridian, Mississippi. Remember all those comforters we had out there, all of those quilts? And she made those quilts, and that was a demonstration of her love. And she gave those comforters to various people, just like the Father gives the comforter of the Holy Spirit to us, to do that unique and special thing that only divinity can do in times of distress. Life is a gift from God, not to be used as we see fit, but to be used as He sees fit. So let us remember that life is a gift, and let us demonstrate our gratitude to Him for the gift of life by being good and faithful servants. God bless your family, and we love you so much. When I see your faces, I just can't help but think back 47 years ago. 47 years ago, we were all together, along with some that are no longer here with us now. God bless you.
Not sure if I see Pastor Parker. No? Early this week, I was looking for some files for the church here, and I came across the home and school packet that Sister Mary Bradford gave me when I first became a pastor of this church. And immediately I just was flooded with memories of our first conversation, as I was amazed that although it was December, she was already planning for June of the next year. And the burden on her heart were the young people that were in college, those who were graduating, making sure that they received care packages while they were away at school, making sure that their milestone, their graduation, was recognized. And I began to get a window into Mary Bradford, that she was somebody that truly loved and cared about people, and she was willing to do whatever she could do in order to make their lives a blessing or to be a blessing to them. But also remember when we finally had the graduation, this was after she'd been diagnosed, and one of the few times she was able to come back to church, but she would not miss that event, and she came in her graduation gown in a wheelchair. That's how important that was to her. But the more I got to know Mary Bradford, I think what stands out about me, it's very clear that she loved people, and you could see by her faith that was revealed in her love for others. But I remember when she first was diagnosed with the cancer, and I remember going to visit her the day after she received the diagnosis, and I was amazed at just how much she was praising God even though she had received that diagnosis. And I remember leaving the hospital that day encouraged by her faith. Then I remember the next time when she was going to the doctor to be treated, and they told her everything that she would do. And when we left there that day, she was just as optimistic as she was when she first got the diagnosis. Her faith in God had not wavered. But then I saw her a few weeks later, and I could tell that her faith was being tested. And I watched her go down into the valley, and I began to really pray for her. I was a little worried. But then I remember the last time I saw her before she passed away, and it was a different Mary Bradford. I could tell in her eyes and in her conversation that she had come to the place of complete trust in Jesus Christ. The Word of God tells us, "Blessed are those who die in the Lord, for their works do follow them." It's one thing to die without knowing Jesus, but it's another thing to die in Jesus, knowing Him at peace, because that means that when he comes back again, that he will raise us back to life again. And so let's be encouraged that Sister Bradford's faith was a testimony of the love of God, and that the assurance that she will live again with him for eternity. At this time, we want to welcome Sister Tara C. We just made a slight adjustment. She's going to come and sing a song for us to encourage our hearts. While she's coming, I want to acknowledge that I understand Sister Bradford was very involved in the YMCA, and she has quite a few people who are here today, friends who worked with her who are here. And we just want to invite you to stand so that we can see you and acknowledge your work and the work that she had with you throughout all those years. Amen. 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 So good to see you. This time, Sister C will come.
Good afternoon, family. I want to express my appreciation to Sister Lowe and the entire family for an opportunity to share a song of hope. When we lose individuals that are dear to us, we need hope. And this may not go far past the minute right now, but I pray that you will accept that there will be peace in the valley for you. Well, I'm tired and so weary, but I must toil on till the Lord comes and calls me away. Oh, yes, and the morning is bright and the night is as fair as the day.
There will be peace. grass and the valley for me.
I invite you to turn your attentions to the obituary. We'll give you an opportunity just to read that silently as we reflect on Sister Bradford's life.
Thank you. Good evening. I recruited some of my cousins to come on the stage with me because I just saw my name on the program, and I said, what can I say about Auntie? So the last funeral we had, nobody believed what I said, so I'm going to give it a try again this time. I noticed in reading her thing that you guys forgot that she was my assistant adventure director for at least 6-7 years. So Mary Bradford helped me with the adventure. She was my organizer. I can make the adventure shine, but I got to have somebody in the background keeping their uniforms together and keeping me organized. So that was one thing that I noticed that was missed in the reflection. She went to every youth congress, every federation with me. I remember one of my reflections, I'm gonna call my cousins out and y'all tell me. One time when we, Benji, wave your hand, he was over Dynamic Praise years ago, and Mama and Auntie, Benji was here in Nashville at a youth federation or something, up directing Dynamic Praise, and Mama and Auntie walked down the center aisle while he was directing. His back was against them. I mean, as they were coming up, they saw his back. Benji didn't even know that they were coming. And they stopped him indirectly while he was directing Dynamic Praise and gave him a hug. So that's one thing. Stanley, Auntie is going to forgive you for giving her them pork and beans that you hid in the in the trash.
And she said they were good.
Yeah, she said they were good, but after we realized that Stanley hid the can in the trash. So, AT, she forgives you. Our first family reunion was here in Nashville, and it was at the Juke Junk. Lo, you remember the Juke Junk? Everybody remember Juke Junk? Yes, but it was at the Juke Junk right down here on Clarksville Highway. And Low owned a Juke Junk back in the day. And Auntie wasn't here yet. She was still in California. But I'm going to tell you one thing about her. She's very classy. Very classy. I mean, she's not coming out of the house without everything just right. I'm trying to think of, is there any other stories y'all want to tell about Auntie? I mean, I had some. I forgot it. Anybody else out in the audience got any?
Well, my favorite reflection of Auntie is camp meeting. When we went to camp meeting, we loved to have family there, you know. So Auntie, when we got there, we always had to unpack her van. I didn't know so much could go in her van until you unpacked it. But the other thing, like Jackie said, she made an appearance when she came in. So she would always have us to save her a seat during 11 o'clock hour. So she could walk in with her sunglasses on, sit on the front row, and fall asleep. That's my auntie.
And then also at camp meeting, we always would go shopping.
That was our favorite.
Every camp meeting, yeah. We went shopping, right?
Right.
And now it's time my turn, okay? Good evening, everyone. So good to see all those smiling faces out there. I got really several stories, but I think I'll try to narrow them down to at least two. Back in the day, grandmama, my mama, and auntie would prepare cornbread. And anytime we got to eat dinner, I would say, I want auntie's cornbread. And I think this kind of irritated my mama until one day, grandmama and mama got together and said, you need to tell them what's going on with that cornbread. Come to find out, all those years I was eating that cornbread, it had sugar in it. And I was tearing it up. I was like, wow, this is the best cornbread. Mama said, Junior, that's sugar in that cornbread. So, Lo, I know you was eating sugar too, just like me, okay? So, yeah, sugar in the cornbread. But this is one that I will always remember. I think I was 5 years old. And my mama and daddy was getting into it. And I climbed up on the table, chair. And I said, don't you talk to my mama like that. Now, you remember the cartoon Tweety Bird? I don't know where my daddy came up with that sucker punch, but he knocked me out. All I know was I was looking up and my auntie came in like Superman. And next thing I know, my daddy was going down himself. Don't you ever hit that boy. So, you know, my auntie stood up for me. She fought for me. And the thing is, my daddy never complained, but I know he went to the hospital. And next thing I know, he had a patch over his eye saying, I ain't gonna hit you no more, son, not with Mary around.
No, I forgot to tell y'all, I don't know if you all know, but she was a fighter. She fought for her sisters, especially Sally Lowe. She
what? Hallelujah.
Yes. But, okay, on a better note, I just want to let my family, I'm talking to my family right now. Guys, the Lord is coming soon. He really, oh, you're not done? Okay.
Lorenzo, you remember the dog called Snowball? My aunt was in Florida, and my mama called Auntie and told her, Snowball has been picked up by the dog pound. She said, you go get my dog now. My mama didn't have a car. She walked to get that dog for Auntie, Snowball. I'm so glad Snowball is somewhere else, because we had to walk to get that dog.
Okay, well, I'm gonna end it by just letting you all, my family, know that the Lord is coming soon. And Mama, I'm so glad you and Auntie got it together. I'm so glad, because Auntie moved to Nashville not only to be with Lorenza, but to be with her best friend, which is Mama. And I'm just so glad that they were able to come together and get it together and to love each other. Sometimes we don't know why God do what he do, but family, the Lord is coming soon. And we got a lot of people that we want to see. Most of all, we want to see Jesus, but we have a lot of family that we want to see. And Auntie didn't have no teeth in her mouth. Oh, okay. Anyway, Felicia, I just want to tell you I miss you. I'm going to miss you, but I am going to see you when we get to heaven. Amen. Thank you.
I'm looking at the May family, and by the looks on some of your faces, you're wondering, who is this little man up here? Well, I want you to know that my wife, Althea, my daughter, LaToya, and myself, Lou, is part of your extended family, and you didn't know that. About 44 years ago, my daughter, my wife, and myself became part of the May family. So we have always been there through Andrew, Mary, Janie, May, just adopted us, and we knew that there were other family members, but we didn't know you. Several years later, I had the privilege of meeting Mary. She came to the house, and I was introduced as, not by any title, but I was introduced by Daddy Lou, because all the kids and Mary and Andrew call me Daddy Lou, call my wife Nanny. So after that, I think we moved further away from them, and I did not see Mary again until we came to Hillcrest. And as soon as I walked in the lobby, Sabbath morning, somebody ran up to me, grabbed me, and said, "Daddy Lou, what are you doing here?" And from that time on, we began to get to know that the May family was huge. We met Jackie, then Sally, and then I think we met some of you during the second family reunion that you had here at Hillcrest. And then I was just saying to myself, wow. Thank the Lord that I'm part of an extended family. Through the years, we got to know different ones of you, and I will admit that there are still many of you that I don't know, but perhaps I'll get to meet you today. But we really became involved in Mary in her own way, kind of saw to that. We became involved in her fundraising activities. And I can remember one Sabbath she came and said, I'm raising money. I forget what it was for, maybe Hunter and F.H. Jenkins. There were a number of activities going on. And she said, remember, the donation has to be equivalent to the size of the shoes you wear. And then again, she said, she told my wife, you need to have a tea at your house. And I think my wife said, a tea? Kind of like, why? Well, you're going to raise some money, but there are no tea bags. So I don't know how you have a tea without tea bags. But at any rate, Mary had many novel ideas about how to relieve you or to make your wallet be smaller. But you know, I thought of that more in terms of spiritual gifts. That was her gift. She knew how to be charitable. She knew how to be supportive. And she knew exactly what her goal was. Last night, she came to mind. And it came to mind because on home and school meetings, programs, she would have all the graduates and then some of us as adults to participate in the program, on the program. And I remembered very meticulously, just before we were ready to march in, she would have her little list, and she'd go down, and she would say something like, "Daddy Lou, you're supposed to be here." And she would line us all up. A thought came to my mind, as I said last night, and I was thinking about what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. He says that when that great getting up morning comes, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then those of us who are still living, should we be, we will what? Be caught up. And as I thought of that, I thought, okay, by the grace of God, I and my family and all of us will be there, but I just imagine Mary will say, "Daddy Lou, you made it."
When the Lord created Mary, he gave her the gift of teaching. Along with the gift, the Lord instilled in her a life mission. The Lord told her that children will have to learn that all men are not just, all men are not true, but that for every scoundrel, there's a hero, that for every selfish being, there's a dedicated leader, and that for every enemy, there is a friend. Jesus told her that although it will take time to teach children that a dollar earned is far more valuable than five found, teach children to learn to lose, but also to enjoy winning. Steer the children away from envy. Teach children the secret of quiet laughter, because laughter invigorates the soul. Let them learn early that the bullies are the easiest to lick. Teach children the wonder of books, but also give them quiet time to ponder over the eternal mystery of the birds in the sky, bees in the sun, and flowers on a green hillside. Teach children that it is far more honorable to fail than to cheat. Teach children to have faith in their own ideas, even if everyone tells them they are wrong. Most importantly, teach children to be compassionately strong in the hour of the weak. Give children the strength not to follow the crowd when everyone else is getting on the bandwagon. Teach them to scrutinize choices and to make wise decisions. Teach them to filter all they hear on a screen of truth and take only the good that comes through. Teach them to ask the Lord to comfort them when they are sad, but also teach the children that there is no shame in tears. Teach children how to sell their abilities to the highest bidders without putting a price tag on their hearts and souls. Teach them to close their ears to the howling mob of non-purpose and to stand up for social justice and for those who cannot speak. Teach the children to have the courage to become problem solvers while instilling in them the patience to be brave. Teach them always to have sublime faith in an almighty God, because only then will they be able to walk in the light. "This is a big order," the Lord told her, "but see what you can do. They are such fine little ones, my children." Well, Mary fulfilled her mission and closed her eyes in rest. Her students have matriculated to higher learning. Her bulletin boards have been cleared. Her final report card has been written. She has earned all A's in the subject of life, and she has worked well with others. Mary's name is on the Lord's honor roll with special recognition for good citizenship toward mankind. Her classroom of faith has been closed out by the administrator of grace, who has recorded Mary's name in the attendance book of life. Mary has fought the good fight, finished her course, and kept the faith. And we will see her again in her heavenly classroom in the sweet by and by.
I have words of comfort for the family of Mary Bradford, Sally Lowe, and the entire May family. And at this time, on behalf of the Master Workers Club, and I would like for them to stand with me as I read to you the words of comfort. although it's difficult today to see beyond the sorrow, may looking back in memory help comfort you tomorrow. Our dear sister, Mary Bradford, was a member of the Master Workers Club in good and regular standing for over 10 years. Mary was serious and meticulous, and I think you know that. Even in the way she dressed, the way she carried herself, she was that Fastenisha kind of woman. She was just as dedicated to master's workers as she was to the usher board, to the home and school department as leader, and any other role the Lord saw fit for her to serve. Always dedicated and ready to work for the master. Mary was on time. She was an on-time person, so when she would set a date for an upcoming graduation, school supply giveaway, or any other program, she would always start early in the year making sure the church members knew exactly what to donate for her students, as Daddy Lou just told us. Mary also believed in Christian education, and she was a strong advocate for all of her students here at Hillcrest. This year, when Mary became ill, she proudly led the 2019 graduation processional in her graduation regalia. She wanted to make sure everything was in place for her students. Oh, the determination. I'm sorry. This is hard for me. Mary was just as passionate about master's workers. She held the position of chaplain, and at every meeting she would read a devotional thought, then give a brief sermonette. She was always willing to share some words of wisdom with the young ladies in the club, and she would never hesitate to voice her opinion when it came to matters she felt strongly about. Where's that fight you were talking about, Junior? She loved her son. She loved her family. And most of all, Mary loved her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our dear sister will greatly be missed, but we all look forward to that day when all we will be united and the Lord will say to us all, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Well done. Have you been faithful over a few things? Now I will make you ruler of many." This has been submitted respectfully by Shalita Statica Walker, President, Vicki Grant Martinez, Corresponding Secretary. Words of comfort. Thank
you. We gratefully express our appreciation for all the acts of kindness shown during our time of bereavement. Perhaps you sent a lovely card or sat quietly in a chair. Perhaps you sent a floral spray. If so, we saw it there. Perhaps you spoke the kindest words as any friend could say. Perhaps you were not there at all, just thought of us that day. Whatever you did to console our hearts, we thank you so much, whatever the part. The family of Mary M. Bradford. To the family of Mary Bradford, I had the pleasure to meet Mrs. Bradford when she cared for my newborn, Ajua. Mrs. Bradford was so loving and kind, I will be forever grateful for the care she provided to my daughter. Find comfort in the words written in the Psalms, "For God cares for you." You keep track of all my sorrows. You have collected all my tears in your bottle. You have recorded each one in your book. Humbly submitted, Judge Allegra Montgomery Walker. In loving memory of Mary M. Bradford, there is now a hush in our hearts as we come together to pay our respects to the memory of one whose life was ended when Jesus allowed her to rest in his loving arms. According to his tender mercy, God, who is infinite in his wisdom, has seen fit to remove from our midst our beloved sister in Christ by means of death on September 11th, 2019. Death, be not proud, though some have called thee mighty and dreadful, for thou art not so. Whereas Sister Mary M. Bradford was a sister, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, and humanitarian. Whereas Sister Mary M. Bradford was a true believer who started her walk with God at the Ephesus SDA Church in Meridian, Mississippi, and continued her walk at the Tamarind SDA Church in California, and finally serving the Lord at Hillcrest SDA Church. Whereas our sister was a faithful member of the Ebony Ensemble, where she sang to the glory of the Lord. Whereas our sister was a member of the Master Workers Club, where she worked tirelessly to raise funds to assist Hillcrest in carrying the message to the community. Whereas our sister was a chairperson of the home and school team, she led the team in preparing back-to-school boxes for college-bound students and backpacks filled with supplies for elementary, middle school, and high school students. Whereas our sister was a beloved children's Sabbath school teacher. Whereas our sister took great pride in recognizing academic milestones each year and directed a solemn ceremony each spring to let students know how proud she and the church were of their accomplishments. Whereas our sister was committed to working with the homeless and donating to the nursing homes. Whereas our sister was a lifelong learner and earned the bachelor's degree of elementary education from University of Southern Mississippi and a master's of education degree from Mississippi State University. Whereas our sister began a 32-year teaching career at the Meridian Public School System for 12 years, then moving to Compton, California, where she taught elementary students for an additional 20 years, and finally ending her teaching career at Born Again Christian Academy in Nashville. Whereas our sister enrolled her beloved great-grandson Hunter at F.H. Jenkins Preparatory School and then became a volunteer at the school for 5 years. Whereas our sister visited the sick, held the hand of the dying, and uplifted those who experienced unfair atrocities in human life. Whereas we believe the words of Jesus in John 14 that encourages us, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." Whereas we are all experiencing a profound sadness, we know that warm rays of joyous sunshine will come in that great getting up morning. And so the family accepts the will of a sovereign God in the passing of their loved one. Therefore, be it resolved that we embrace the family, because all of us have a common bond that will connect us for the rest of our lives. We cannot replace Mary, but we will attempt to demonstrate her love for you. Be it further resolved that although we as a church family are in a period of mourning, we realize because we are children of the light, we hold firm to the promises of God. He has promised us that soon there will be no night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again, and praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we always be with the Lord. Humbly submitted, Hillcrest Seventh-day Adventist Church family, Marlon Reed, pastor.
just reach into your pocket and he'll make it stay.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the saith Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, pray. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me, wilt be
Thank you, Pastor, for reminding us of who we need to trust in times like these. To this very special family, thank you for affording me this opportunity to just share a word from the Lord with you on a day like today. I could share a few stories about Miss Mary, too. Miss Mary knew how to keep me straight. Sister Bradford had a way of calling me on the phone, and she had two tones in her voice. There was a singing tone, Pastor Stokes. At that point, I knew everything was all right. I hadn't messed up in any way. But then there was another tone that was just a little deeper. And at that point, I knew that there was a problem that must be dealt with. But I also knew that Miss Mary loved this church, loved her family, and loved her God. And so thank you for giving me this opportunity. Father, be with us these next few moments, I beg, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Usually on a grave marker, there are two dates, and neither of them do we have much control over. I was looking at the obituary, and I noticed October 16, 1934, through September 11, 2019. And there's something about these two dates that elicit a myriad of emotions. The ooh and the owing of the joy of the newborn baby, that birth. Then there is the despair of loss, the sadness of losing a loved one, and the hurt because they won't be there anymore. I was just yesterday sitting with a family who lost their 92-year-old mom and grandmother, and even at 92, the family was still feeling the pain of loss. Two dates that we have very little control over. But we fail to look at this little dash, this little hyphen in the middle of those two dates. That dash, that hyphen, I've learned has everything to do with how I lived during those two dates. You know, I was looking at Job, and Job asked the question about the hyphen. He didn't ask so much about the birth and the death. He said, it's the hyphen that matters. He said, if a man dies, shall he live again? And then he says, all the days of my heart's service, I will wait until my change comes. You see, the dash represents every act of service, every life-changing moment, every tear that has been shed, every pain that has been felt, every meal that has been served, every loving act of a mother, a grandmother, a sister, and an aunt. Oh, the hyphen is what really matters. I know we celebrate the birth and mourn at the death, but right in the middle of all of that, there's this hyphen, and I learned something about Mary's hyphen, her dash in life, is that she loved Jesus, she loved her family, and she loved her church. Her hyphen meant more than anything. And so Job is asking a real question. He says, if a man dies, shall he live again? And you see, the answer to this question has more to do with the dash or the hyphen. Notice what Job says, if a man dies, shall he live again? You know the story of Job. He was going through some things. He was being tempted beyond human reasoning, but he looked beyond what this life had to offer. He was thinking about something more than just what he had down here. He was thinking about a whole different world, a world where there would be no more separation. no more temptation, no more tribulation, no more hospitalization, no more excommunication, no more discrimination. Job said, if a man dies, shall he live again? But then he goes on, he says, and I'm going to hang in here all the days of my appointed life. And I had a hard time with this quote, and I found out that it's a strange way of talking like a soldier. This is soldier talk right here. It's a term that is borrowed from soldiers. It's a term that soldiers use. And what it was saying, I will serve until I'm discharged from my duty. I'm going to fight the good fight. It's warfare talk. And I want to declare to you today, y'all forgive me for just a moment. I believe Miss Mary knew something about warfare. I believe that her mind was made up. I'm going to serve until I'm discharged from duty. My last experience here at a funeral was Mary serving people. I'm going to serve till my change comes. I'm going to serve till I'm discharged from duty. And then Job says, I will wait till my change comes. Job, what are you talking about here? This is where hope takes up residence. And I'm going to take my seat in just a moment. But this is what gets me up in the morning. This is what gives me a reason to go on and press towards the mark. You know, in the last 30 days, this is my fourth funeral, and on Sunday, I'll have my fifth funeral. But there's something that keeps me going inside, something that has to do with a change coming. There's something that gives me a ray of hope. There's something that says that, you know what, it won't be much longer. Your change is going to come. There's some light at the end of the tunnel, and there's a promise here for you and a promise for me. There's something for us to stand on as a family as we go through this time of loss. I don't know about you, but I don't want to go through many more funerals like this. But I understand that the reality of life is that some must die, and there will be a few more funerals, but I'm glad to report to you today that it won't be much longer. Change is going to come. And I'm not talking about political change. I'm not talking about monetary change. I'm talking about real change. I'm talking about a change that cannot be hindered or blocked. A change that's already been set in place. A change that says that when I come, I'm coming to get my children, and I'm going to take them back home with me, and there'll be no more separation, no more death, no more pain, no more sorrow. I'm talking about real change. And my Bible says that change is going to come. Job said, I'm going to hold on till my change comes. And I want to bother you for just a moment and ask the question. Anybody like that just want to make up in your mind? You want to hold on until your change comes. I'm not talking about a change of clothes. I'm talking about real change. I'm talking about a change that keeps every child of God looking forward instead of looking back. I'm talking about a change that says one day soon and very soon, he that shall come and will not keep silent. I'm looking forward to that day. That's my hope. That's what I stand on. I can't let go of it. I wish I had about five people that were looking for that change. The change is real. How do you know, preacher? Paul kind of painted the picture for me. Paul said that if you and I didn't have a little hope that a change is going to come, we'd be men most miserable. As a matter of fact, Pastor, our preaching would be in vain. Here's what he said. He said, and if Christ had not risen, then our preaching is in vain. Your faith is in vain, family. Yea, we were found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up. If so, he that are dead will not raise up. For if the dead raise up, then Christ is not raised. But I got good news for somebody here this afternoon. Christ got up. And because Christ got up, guess what? Miss Mary's going to get up. And some other folk are going to get up. There's a little hope at the end of this rainbow. Catch verse 19. He says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, then we are all men most miserable. That's why the Bible says that we grieve, but we don't grieve like those who have no hope. We have hope that one day soon and very soon, the trump of God, I heard it. The trump of God is going to sound, and the dead in Christ are going to start popping up out of there. I wish I had about five people that want to be there when the dead in Christ start raising up out of their graves. And one writer said that, and we who are alive, there are going to be some folk alive. They're going to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. And then we will forever abide in his presence. Oh, but Paul doesn't stop there. He says that this mortal who is subject to death right now shall put on immortality, which means he will no longer be subject to death. And this corruptible, this person whom corruption and sin has taken a hold of, will be erased. That corruptible thing of him will be erased from him. And this corruptible must put on incorruption, which means I'll no longer be subject to death. I want to be there. I want to see him. And so here's what gets me up in the morning. What gets me up in the morning, what gives me a little hope, what allows me to be a little loud at a funeral, is the hope that I have in Christ Jesus. I can't put my hope in my politicians. I can't put my hope in friends and family like I would like to. But I do put my hope in Jesus. And here's what he said, because I got up. Yeah. Y'all forgive me right now. Y'all forgive me. I'm getting a little warm in here. Because he got up. I wish I had about five people that believe that, because when he got up, you and I can get up. Mama Mary can get up. Because he got up early Sunday morning, he got up. Because he got up, there's some hope in this place right now. There's this strange story. It took place in Hanover, Germany. A grave was placed there, and the owner of the grave said, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to fix this grave so that just in case there is a resurrection. She didn't believe in the resurrection. She said, just in case there is a resurrection, I want you to fix it so nothing can open this grave. That was her direction. That's what she said. And I want to make sure that this burial place will never be open. What happened in time, a seed fell on the earth on top of the stones and mixed in with the earth, and the seed began to grow and grow, and slowly it was pushing its way through the soil and out from beneath them. As the trunk of the tree enlarged, the great slabs of the grave were gradually being shifted so that the steep and steel claps that were holding the grave in place, they were broken out of their sockets. A tiny seed had begun to sprout a tree, and the tree pushed the stones away. Oh, y'all aren't here. If a little old seed can break up some stones, what do y'all think Jesus can do? I've come to tell you that the God I serve has enough power to call life back into existence. And here's what my Bible says, that he is going to do it one more time. My hope is that as a family, and as a church, as a people of God, it will be within our hearts for that great reunion up in the portals of glory. Hey, can you all see it? Y'all just about packed this church out. Yeah. But can you all imagine the combination of this family at the Tree of Life? Can you imagine the first picnic? You know, I've been with you all through a couple of these experiences. Can you imagine the reunion between loved ones who went down in their graves believing that God is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Can you imagine what it will be like when we stand together and celebrate no more death, no more pain, no more sorrow? Got to ask a quick question as I take my seat. Anybody want to be there? Anybody want to be there? Anybody just want to see Jesus and behold his face and have that great reunion? I hope y'all don't mind if I crash the party and show up at the Tree of Life with you all. I hope you don't mind if we just talk about how good the Lord is. We won't even have to worry about how good he's been. I mean, just the fact that we made it, you and I ought to celebrate that. And then I won't have to worry about Miss Mary, the tone of her voice when I hear her voice. And to her son and the rest of the family. Don't you want to be there? I know I do. But here's what I need to tell you. There's only one way to get there. And that we must live the dash of our lives for him. Father, be with this family in a special way. Keep them. Remind them of just how sufficient your grace is. Comfort them. Comfort her siblings. Comfort her son. Comfort her grandchildren and great-grand. Remind them, Lord, that your love is sufficient. And that one day, soon and very soon, you're coming back. Help us to be ready, we pray. In Jesus' name. Hey, church, if you trust him, why don't you pause for a moment and just give God some praise? Because he is able.
Shall applaud with thunders of praise, and the sweet light in his eyes his glory. shall behold him, yes, face to face. He is our Savior and our Lord. The angels shall sound.
Praise the Lord for that song. just before our elder brings us our benediction, just a few things we want to bring to your attention as we prepare to leave. There will be a graveside service. We'll be leaving here, getting into our cars. Also, there will be a repast back here at the Hillcrest Church immediately following our services by the graveside. We're also asking that those of you who are in the audience, that you would remain in your seated area when the ministers and the family are proceeding out. And so just so you can, if you can do that for us until the family's out, then you can join us in exiting the building. This time we'll ask Elder Majors to come as he closes us out with benediction.
Let us bow our heads. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to celebrate the life of Mary Branford. But we know that there will be a time when grief will overwhelm us. In those hours, Lord, help us to remember what Jesus said, which is, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, you believe in me. I'm going to my Father's house to prepare a place just for you. And Jesus said, if I go, I'll be back. So Lord, help us all to remember that Jesus promised that he'd be back, and that we only have to hold out just until Jesus comes. Please come quickly. Bless this family. May your Holy Spirit comfort them in their lives moving forward, and make us all ready so when Jesus comes, we can go back with him. In his name we pray. Amen.
Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. The trumpet shall sound, the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. Thank you.